This is KT Connects, hosted by the Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research and Arthritis Research Canada. And it is my pleasure to introduce today Cheryl Koehn, who is here to present Discipline as a KT Agent, Keeping the Government Informed About Research. Cheryl Koehn is an arthritis advocate, a community leader, a published author, and a rheumatoid arthritis survivor for 28 years. She's also the founder and president of Arthritis Consumer Experts, which is a national organization that provides science-based information and education programs in both English and French to people with arthritis. So thank you, Cheryl, for being here today. I'm now going to pass over the presentation to you.
Thank you very much, Jenny. It's really both a pleasure and a privilege to be here, and I want to thank the Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research and Arthritis Research Canada for hosting what has turned out to be, I think, a really groundbreaking series and one that has added value not just, I think, to the research community, but to my patient KT agent community. It's been really interesting. We've been able to participate in, I think, each one and have learned a lot. So thank you very much for this opportunity to be here with you today. This is today's agenda. Over the next sort of 40 or so minutes, I'm going to walk you through some of these topics and dive down a little bit deeper into each one. But I'd like to start, as this slide indicates, on sort of providing a context and perspective, which I think are really important in KT. That if you're talking to an audience, they should know who you are, what you're about, where you come from. And so I'll take a minute to do that with you today. It's always important to understand where sources of funding come from so that your audience can judge whether you're walking the talk or perhaps whether influence may be at play. And so I always like to share with you, as an employee of Arthritis Consumer Experts, where sources of funding come from. We do assure our members, no matter who they are, and our partners in academia, with our professional colleagues, that our work is free from the influence of its funders and guided solely by its board and its membership. I think another thing in terms of providing you context is understanding that I'm speaking with you today as someone living with disease. As Jenny mentioned, I do view myself as a survivor, much like a patient with cancer would. I have the misfortune to have a disease that has no cure, has some pretty good treatments now, but we certainly need a lot more. So it's sort of a life sentence, but it's how you view it, how you deal with it, I think. That makes a difference throughout your life, and I'm blessed to be able to engage with people with my disease and many other chronic diseases and helping them through education, information, and advocacy activities so that they really do feel in control of their lives. So it's from this context, of this perspective, that I share my thoughts with you today. We have about 17,000 members in the country. We reach about 125,000, and we'll see, I think, in some of the case study work that I'm going to share with you today, how we do that through patient KT, and how we engage actually with our, what we call sister arthritis consumer groups and organizations. So I'm really, feel quite fortunate to be embedded in an organization that is really by, for, and with people with arthritis. So I think the place to start when talking about citizens, or as I move forward, I'm going to refer to us as patient KT agents, is to try to grapple with a definition of who is a citizen or a patient KT agent. But I thought before I offered those few comments, we'd start with a working definition of KT, given that this is a KT webinar series and the topic of today's talk and all others. I thought this was probably the mothership to draw down a definition, and that is from the CIHR. And all of you, I'm sure, are quite familiar with this definition. And I bolded there the two words that, for me as a patient KT agent, really resonate and make sense. That it is, the KT process is a dynamic one, and it's iterative in that there is back and forth and a constant sharing of messages, testing of messages, challenging of messages, and then rethinking, reframing, and redisseminating messages. So And obviously it takes place in a complex system. So this is sort of the academic version of KT, but I thought it would be kind of cool, given I'm coming from the street, with my talk on patient KTs, patient KT agents, that we look at what Wikipedia says is KT. And I don't know, for people like me, for people that you're trying to, audiences you're trying to reach, government, healthcare professionals, patients, of course, that if we thought of KT as an umbrella term for all of the activities that move from research from the lab, and I would say even before the lab, it's an idea in a person's head at the very beginning, moved into the lab, studied carefully in people like me, through research journals, academic conferences. It's actually naming these things. What is a complex environment? What is a dynamic exchange? And I kind of like this definition, taking nothing away from the CIHR, but if you were to try to talk to people like me about what it is you do or are interested in, I would offer that this is probably a good place to start. So with that as backdrop, and that is my working definition, I'd like to just make some comments, I think, to start about who is a patient KT agent. Really, it's anyone who is a patient and who speaks from that perspective to communicate not just experiences but views to one or more audiences. So specifically, I've included governments in the title of my talk because I know that researchers are really interested in doing a better job, not just in terms of sharing with them their knowledge so that they can hopefully build health policy that has a direct and improved impact on people's lives, but also to be accountable for the funds that are being disseminated across the country. And I think patients and public really do appreciate that accountability and that activity. Patient KT agents obviously bring unique and varied experience, and you can see there in that bullet point list just a few of them. That patient KT agents are just as the picture to the right depicts. As patients were snowflakes, and as KT agents were snowflakes, we bring a really, really cool mix of ingredients that allow us to either work or volunteer as patient KT agents. I want to tell you that no one is born a patient KT agent. I didn't crawl out of my diaper and, you know, go on to kindergarten setting out to become a patient KT agent, and I would suggest to you no one who's doing this today, volunteer or paid, actually did. You just become one. And when I was asked to give this talk, I do all my thinking when I'm walking my dog. I was struggling. Well, how did it happen to me? I know I wasn't born one, so how did it happen to me? So we put together this image, and I'm so grateful that my team chose this lovely blonde-haired young woman to be me. I feel quite happy about that. But you can see here this lovely young woman doing a variety of activities, and this was me at 27 years old. And I, you know, got up and probably like a lot of people who enjoy really good health and a safe environment in family and work and socially, did all these things, you know, personal hygiene, going to work, shopping. Yes, I have been to a nightclub from time to time. Tennis, washing your car, you know, life. That's life on the screen, and that's who I was. And in an instant, I couldn't do any of those things. That in the size of a month of developing rheumatoid arthritis, I was virtually wheelchair-bound. I was unable to chew my food. And it's that point in time, as I was walking my dog, thinking about this talk, that I know I became a patient KT agent, because I experienced this profound disease onset. And I don't care if it's a cold or the flu or rheumatoid arthritis or cancer. When you get it and you deal with it and you figure out ways to overcome it, hopefully you can, with the help of friends, family, and professionals, you become a KT agent because you have to begin articulating what's happening to you in order to get help. And I actually think it's the N of one. It's your own experience of disease or illness challenge that brings you to the stage of patient KT. So it's situation, timing, your skill set, educational level, your interest, your knowledge of research and research processes, among so many other factors. These are the things with a disease onset or an illness onset that give birth to a patient KT agent. So if something happens to you and you have all of those things above it there that propels you forward to open your mouth. Another thing I think that makes up a big piece that makes up a patient KT agent is someone who has the willingness and the patience to listen and to understand their local context, to develop insights and importantly build relationships that enable them to actually talk, speak out, first of all, and then adapt the things they're saying to the people they're trying to communicate to so that they can see acceptance, understanding, and action. It's those things, I think, that are very, very important in helping you to become a KT agent and an effective one. So that's just a brief sketch of some of the things that make up a patient KT agent. Let's talk about the role of patients as KT agents. I think most of the people on the phone, and certainly in this room, we would agree that patients play a very important role on the spectrum of health, from governance to research to the care delivered and obviously to the policy making that affords all of those things before it to happen. They, I think, are the center of all activities related to health. I talk to my colleagues, it's funny when we go to meetings and things, and you know, you read it all of the time in the literature about patient-centered this and patient-centered that. And I believe researchers believe that. I'm not so sure governments believe it or have difficulty maybe getting there. And patients, interestingly, don't often see themselves as such. When we do focus group work, they don't necessarily, out on the street, the general public view themselves as the center of something. And I think it's essential that the public do view ourselves as patients, as being at the center, and then what does it look like? Well, I think another thing that the healthcare system has to understand is that patient KT agents, they live with these things, so diseases, illnesses, challenges, that the healthcare system is trying to fix. And I'm using street language here in these slides so that you understand as a community of researchers and possibly patients as KT agents who are on the line, we understand that we have to develop a new vocabulary. And you actually have to be really diligent about using the vocabulary. So it's not enough to write, you know, lay abstract to get the grant. You actually have to incorporate that language into your everyday work with patients if, in fact, you want to be successful with patient KT agents. And there are dozens of places along the health spectrum where patient KT agents should be and are needed. And again, I have to give a huge shout out here to the Michael Smith Foundation and to Arthritis Research Canada, and I know dozens of other institutions across the country dedicated at funding and producing excellent research. You guys have been leaders, and you should be very, very proud of that. I think British Columbia, where we're lucky enough to have our head office, has pioneered in a lot of ways, first of all, consumer and patient participation in research, which is I think, a breeding ground. It's the nursery for patient KT agents. It's to be sheltered by you, to learn from you, and then to be set free to do the things they want to do in their life in the way of transferring information in their own language and through their own very lay channel. KT agents, and I know you heard this during the last webinar with Sheila Kerr and Kelly English from Arthritis Research Canada. I know that talk was wonderful, and they talked about their role within a research institution. So this might echo certainly in support with what they have offered to you in terms of their own views. But we think patient KT agents serve as evidence reality checks. You know, we work with researchers every day, and I get calls or emails from people just saying, hey, Cheryl,
I saw this. Does that make sense? Does this, do you get a ping in your gut when you hear that, or do you, when you see it, when you read it, when you feel it? And, you know, we're happy to say yes or no or maybe or think of it this way. I think it's that reality check, the very important role that we play in the KT process overall. The prioritization of questions and answers and rolling those into KT activities, I think, is a really important role that we play, as well as an evidence bridge from peer to researcher to policy. The picture I've put in the background there is of the Golden Gate Bridge. I was born in California, so this is my bridge. And I think it's just a great image. When you think about patient KT agents, they are big, strong bridges, and not just of one person or one organization, but a network of patient KT agents living in organizations. I think that make this beautiful span across a knowledge gap. Ultimately, I think, though, they're translators. We take research and medical language from Greek to street. And I have to tell you, I've been doing what I do, volunteered and paid, for a long, long time now, it seems. And I have walked out of so many meetings where I literally thought I had come out of the UN. I did not understand the word. I had no translation device attached to my head. And I had no clue what was spoken about. So we had to go back. And so appreciate this. Patient KT agents work their little fannies off sometimes just to work with your language, your ideas, your concepts, and put them into something we can understand first in order then to translate them into street. So it can be, like research, sometimes a bit of a long process. But it's always very fruitful at the end when you find the magic phrase that seems to light up a person on the street's eyes. I'm going to share with you, sort of to illustrate some of the things that I've spoken about in terms of who a patient KT agent is, our role, in three case studies. And these case studies come from the organization I work for. And involve collaborations and a couple of different audiences. So the first one is patient KT through social media, and it seems to me the obvious place to start in terms of case studies. So I don't know, I think I'm actually down in that audience somewhere on right there, trying to figure out the Greek that's on the slide. But we all know on the phone, and have probably been to hundreds, if not thousands, of medical and scientific conferences ourselves, but they're held nearly every day around the world. There's knowledge being exchanged between researchers and clinicians, other health professionals, every day. And the knowledge exchanged, however, peer-to-peer at these meetings, I'm not being disrespectful, because I know you know it. Sometimes it doesn't get out of the plenary room. Sometimes it gets off the plenary floor and into peer-to-peer journals. But sadly, patients and patient KT agents have no access to them. We are really buoyed by the fact that there are some research journals now that are making free public access to them. So I love it. You have no idea. The hair on the back of my neck stands up when I'm doing a liver review, and I see free patient access, and I don't have to con one of you into getting me the article from your library. So work with me to encourage all publishers to do that. I think it's a really important aspect and underscores the need for this particular case study. Patient KT through social media can be super powerful, and these are some of the reasons why. It's a powerful platform, so they're big, especially for patients and patient KT agents. And why? Because they were built in street language. So we don't have to do any deciphering. You do have to understand some online social programming for their tips and traps, but those are also easily available and free. Patient KT agents and patients in general seek and like to go to places to find people like ourselves. So there's nothing like walking into a room full of people, for me anyway, with rheumatoid arthritis. I feel like I'm at home. I call those people my brothers and sisters every day. They are the only ones who know the same devil that I know, and it's called rheumatoid arthritis. So I understand when researchers get together, when doctors get together, it's a great feeling. you need to sort of turn outward. You need to all get in a circle and then turn around and look out and say, well, who else can we talk to? Who else can we share this experience with? And social media provides you that venue. And we have direct access to everyone, including government. Government loves social media, as you well know, in that BC is in the middle of an election. It brings together people from far and wide. So as diverse as we are as a patient KT community, so are the people living, breathing, eating, and having fun on social media. And it is cheap, obviously, because it's free, mostly. It is mostly easy to use, and it is mostly fun. And we like to call it real-time KT. It is amazing. I saw a tweet come out from Michael Smith this morning saying, hey, little known fact, Cheryl was a passive volleyball player. I mean, that's the power. You can share little known facts and actually get to know something or someone a bit better just with the ease of two thumbs clicking away 140 characters and off you go. So this case study really started about 4 years ago when ACE, arthritis consumer experts, we began conducting patient interviews of medical and clinical research experts at the Canadian Rheumatology Association annual scientific meeting. We started thinking about, hey, if journals aren't available to us, if we're not invited or aren't members of these associations, how can we weasel our way in, find out what they know, and get it out to people like us? We thought that did a couple of things. So the premise behind it is, we know that we have contact with government through our KT platform, and I'll share with you some of those channels at the end. We also know that patients are there, and we also know that health professionals are starting to use social media. So we thought, okay, let's find out what they know at this meeting and turn around and tell people who are using social media. So we set up, we all wanted to be Oprah, let's face it. So we set up a broadcast booth in the main exhibition space because it was free and it was the only place we could weasel our way in. We conducted 10 to 15 interviews over 3 days. It's not that I don't know the real number. Some of them were so poor in quality we couldn't post them. So we couldn't say 10 to 15. Some of the limitations there, you can see poor audio and video during filming. But still, the concept was interesting. And we literally kind of just drag people by the shirt sleeve. Said, hey, Dr. Kelka shows, want to come over here and talk to us? We're just doing little videos. So, you know, it really started in an organic way with an idea that we could tell people that might be interested through our channels about what was happening in the secret world of rheumatology. We then uploaded those videos to YouTube, which is very time-consuming and actually quite costly because someone has to sit there and render, edit the videos, render them, blah, blah, blah. You can also put them on your own website. But the bottom line is how we started was quite difficult to get a conversation going, and I think that's critical with KT. It's not just about putting out a message and then letting the message evaporate into thin air. It's about having someone grab the message and then throw another one back at you, and it's that dynamic, iterative message throwing about, I think, that is really fundamental to good patient KT. So you can see here that in 2014, we did 29 videos. We had 8,600 views, which isn't bad, and that's to date, by the way. So it took us 3 years to get those video views. 2015, you could see there was a big drop. We had issues with logistics, we had issues with equipment, and this is what happens with organic social media sort of KT led by patient KT agents. You have challenge, you're not embedded, and you don't have the safety of the institution looking after your projects, basically. So people fall ill, you know, stuff happens. So that's what happened to our numbers in 2015. But you can see here 4 years later, so this was in February. We convinced the CRA, bless them, they really have taken a shine to this activity. They offered us a room, studio. We hashtag this now, it's called CArthritis, so CRA, which is the acronym for their association. We stream this live, so thank you Facebook and Twitter for creating the live features on your website. We built in a long lead time to establish interview schedules of presenter and attendees. We had a comprehensive pre-live K KT plan, and we're still able to post all of these videos online to YouTube through the Facebook capacity. So we got all of what we were getting before, plus we could go live, plus we could store them for future viewing. Facebook houses everything, as you know. They hold all the secrets to our lives forever. And here's what happened. So this was less than 48 hours worth of work, not including setting up the interviews and the pre-KT plan, or the pre-conference KT plan. We had 32 interviews in less than 48 hours. We reached, 27,000 people. We had 8,800 total views, and those total views came almost within the week of the event, so during and within the week following the event. So huge, huge spike. Facebook likes. If any of you are on social media doing KT, you know that getting a like is not easy. There's actually a fancy formula that costs what a like is. I don't know it, but I can find out. They're hard to get. You can see there those comments, 227 comments were made during these interviews. So you were listening to an expert and had the ability to throw back your ideas about the messages they were hearing and getting some sense of real-time KT engagement. Total shares, and then you can see their total post clicks. I actually think for this audience, the most important metric there is the bottom one. Because every time we interviewed someone, we offered the institution's website, we provided a link to whatever content that person being interviewed wanted us to link to. And you can see there that those were organically generated post clicks through this event in February over 48 hours. So this is just a huge, huge success. Where we moved from this original, idea about trying to be Oprah to being, we think, running now a great KT exercise through social media. Nothing happens without great people to work with. And this is just to remind me to recognize Michael and Kelly and Linda at sister groups and organizations in arthritis for their help in interviewing. So that's the broadcast booth backdrop. We had lighting here. We had a really, really fancy iPhone and an iPad. That was it. And two lavalier, mics. So this was a very successful exercise. And we think the key considerations for patient KT agents using social media as well as researchers are these points that are made in bold. I don't need to read this word to word, but really being resourceful is, I think, vitally important. Being authentic. Social media is about authenticity. It doesn't always have to sound or look professional. You can't be rude. You don't want to be disrespectful. You certainly want to be responsible, for sure. But it's about being authentic and striking, making someone curious about what it is you're talking about. Credibility is key. Being responsive and timely, and as I said a few seconds ago, responsible is really important. I think for patient KT agents who may be joining this audience, your peers begin to rely on you in social media, and you need to be mindful of that. People look for your voice, they look for your views, and they look for the resources that you might have available that they might not. So you have to understand that when you go silent, it will have an impact on your community building a plan to mitigate against any kind of harm. Our second case study is really about patient KT agents working through the patient input process, which is one developed by government. So this is direct patients to government. In 89, I think most of us participating today know that a common drug review was established. It is an exercise that is provincial, territorial, and federal, and it's a process that is aimed at finding out which drugs and technologies coming into our Canadian healthcare system are deemed cost effective and worthwhile paying for out of the public purse, basically. In 2010, so a long time went by before CADTH, the group that actually runs the Common Drug Review, instituted a patient input process. But we were very, very happy about it. We helped participate in the process that built this input process, and are so, so happy that they did. The guideline for participation is there in the link and will be made available, I know, after the webinar. We were very proud, as I know, the Arthritis Society and the Canadian Arthritis Patient Alliance to have been the first to provide submissions to this process. So our MSK community has been well represented in these processes, not just at CADIS, but at provincial governments that now include patient input processes as well. I think for arthritis consumer experts, our input has been, our process model has been regarded by many as sort of a best practice or a first in class. We're really happy about that. And of course, we actively share our model with others through workshops and webinars. So on one hand, I'm saying to you, if you build a model to do this process, to engage in patient KT in these processes that are available at government, you should share your model. Sharing is caring. It just is always a way to remind that, you know, you can't just build things and not share them. Nothing is proprietary in my mind in the world of KT, especially if you're doing it as a patient KT agent. And in that spirit, here is our model. Someone issues a call for patient input. We send it out via our communications platform through telephone, through email. We gather that input and prepare it in the way that the regulatory body or the agency is requesting it. We send it off by a stated deadline, and when we hear word of a listing or a decline, we immediately send off a letter either thanking or seeking clarification on why it was declined. And then we begin to work with government to make certain that they have any missing pieces of knowledge from the patient and a research perspective that they may not have considered in their review. And if, in fact, engagement begins again, we make that loop, we go around that sort of merry-go-round one more time or several times. I think the key consideration whenever you do patient KT with government, whether it's with this input process or any other that government is responsible for, is you must understand sort of inside and out the drug review process in this particular case study. Because how you as an organization interpret the needs of patients, your membership, and transmit that or disseminate that back to government, you have to do it on the basis of knowledge of the system. And often we see patient KT not fully understanding the context or the process. So it's really important to the public to be accountable for that. I think you always have to be kind, compassionate, and thankful to patients who actually engage in that. They are undertaking personal KT agent action by saying, sure, I'll tell you how that therapy might impact my life, or is impacting my life, or how my disease is impacting my life. You have to be prepared, obviously, for rejection, because when, just like for researchers, when you get those thanks for your submission, but no thanks, you get those as patient KT agents all the time. You need to find the positive in it, that you've had an opportunity to provide input, and you also need to figure out a way to get over the obstacle if, in fact, you think the rejection is not necessarily a legitimate one or not one based entirely on the full evidence available. You have to be resilient, obviously. You have to pick yourself up and brush yourself off, just like you do in the research community. And you should share your best patient KT practices, which I said on the last slide. Sharing is caring, and if we all do better at these types of processes, the end result is public, and patients is public, winning big. The third one is really focused on our arthritis medications report card. So this is an example where we have used research knowledge, the ability to look at databases, registries, listings, understand policy, so policy research. This report card was built on research. And we took it upon ourselves to do this because, as the state's slide indicates, from 2002 to 2008, drug formulary reimbursement practices for a class of medications that treat Lyme disease and a number of other autoimmune forms of arthritis really vary from province to province. And as a Canadian, as Canadians who work at Arthritis Canada experts, we really believe that healthcare should be universal in this country. And I don't think there would be any disagreement in this room or with those participating in the call. We felt that Canadians living with autoimmune forms of arthritis, we knew that they had access in one province and didn't in the other. And yet at the same time, patients living with other life-threatening illnesses or chronic diseases did have fairly even access to medical reimbursement on formularies. And the bottom line is the discrimination between patients, between provinces, patients that live and breathe in other provinces. And we really wanted to follow our brothers and sisters in cancer and in HIV and focus on making government understand that it was a discriminatory practice. At the end of the day, not that people were saying we're going to discriminate, but the discrimination was happening nevertheless. So we decided to evaluate performance, which happens all the time in research. And we began to, as citizens, as patients, make governments accountable for what they were listing on their formularies. So we began to rank and compare them. We focused on some key audiences, primarily, obviously, elected officials, being a bureaucrat, but also mainstream media and patients living with autoimmune forms of arthritis to really put the call to action out to them to challenge their system in their province and ask for answers on why things were being reimbursed and why they weren't. We invited other community partners to join us in our report card launch, and we launched in the place you should launch, I think, when it comes to national healthcare topics, and that's in Parliament. So we had a human rights lawyer, we had one of the leading scientific and clinical researchers in the country, myself, and an MP host. And it was really the classic PR for GR exercise. And when we say PR, it is PR is KT. It's done in really street language with sort of calls to action and all manner of other types of things that then earn you a government relations outcome. The report card is updated online every month. It's distributed in print once per year through a comprehensive patient KT plan. And I'll tell you, our number one metric for success is how many cubicles this hangs in provincial formulary offices across the country, how many people in our own community have it hanging up at their desk or folded in that junk drawer we all have in our kitchen. Hey, what's happening in my province? This is the go-to guide for reimbursement for arthritis medications now in Canada. We're very proud to have initiated it, but we're even more proud to rely on our board of experts, clinical and research, to make sure this is evidence-based. And this is our way of taking what you guys do out to policymakers. It couldn't be a better example of that. Another great metric is obviously seeing provinces add medications to the reimbursement formulary, which is exactly what happened. So today, this report card is Canada's only independent patient organization evaluation of reimbursement access to arthritis medication. Since its original publication in 2008, the number of biologics covered across Canada has significantly improved. And we all probably know, if you're in MSK research, know that the class of medications has expanded greatly. From the time that we started, we were ranking 2, and now I think we rank something like 11 different biologics, and now we have targeted small molecules and other medications on the report card. Our patient KT agency dream is to see all provinces rank number 1. It's to see no differences in reimbursement coverage from coast to coast. I think another great metric is what experts say about it, and this comes from the Scientific Director of Arthritis Research Canada, who really underscores the fact that this is a well-researched report confirming gaps. And I think that's what research is. That's the crux of research, asking questions that uncover where limitations are, our gaps are, and finding answers to overcome them. Lastly, I think key considerations for this particular case study. This cartoon illustrates reach. So to do something with policymakers, you have to get to them wherever they live, wherever they read, wherever they hang out. And that's what we try to do with the breadth of our programming. This is a list of some of the channels that we have to communicate what you do as researchers, what you know as researchers, out to patients, out to other patient KT agents, out to policymakers, and anyone else who cares to listen. I'm going to round up this presentation by just talking about a few challenges. I'd like to get those out of the way first and then talk about a few opportunities. Patient KT agents don't enjoy the same power as do other stakeholders. In fact, we have the least amount of power as any other stakeholder does, than any other stakeholder does. And it's because we're the newest kids on the block, I think, in the process. You know, putting patients at the center hasn't been around for decades. So that means you're lower down, basically, in the food chain of power. And it is researchers who, I think, more than anyone, have recognized the power imbalance and are starting to write it. So I thank everyone on the phone for helping us, patient KT agents, who have a keen interest in being your full partners. With power, without power. If you don't have power, I won't have power. If you've got power, I want your power. It's about doing those things together. We sometimes, as patient KT agents, don't know the secret handshake, right? We don't know the politics because we're not in it. We're not in your political sphere. We're not in your power structure. We're not in your knowledge bank. So sometimes we don't know the secret handshake. So reaching out to you and you teaching us that is really, really important to our success, and I would argue for your success. Community politics can certainly get in the way. And then lastly, no surprise, this is the shortfall, the challenge for all of us, and it's funding. Now there is funding to encourage patient engagement in research. Now there's great, you know, SPOR units across, or support units across the country, and entire networks of SPOR researchers. So we think we're overcoming this, but we have some ways to go. Opportunities, well, we do have some power now, and we have credibility to develop specific recommendations for government based on your work, based on our relationship. We can now transfer that out to audiences that have the ability and the willingness to listen. It's easier to be inclusive and nonpartisan in political outreach when you're a patient KT agent. I remember the day I started to go talk to government was the day I realized, hey, I'm a voter. I actually have the right to tell you what I think. And that's so freeing. So I encourage all of you to think that way. You're a voter. And you can actually visit and talk to these people in politics and in government as a civil servant. You can tell them about what you do because you're a voter. Patient KT agents can mobilize communities to support advocacy efforts. I think this is one area where the relationship between patient and researcher is growing really nicely. I think you understand beautifully that we have the ability to do it in ways that you simply don't. And I think that's kind of cool. And we'd like to leverage community events and meetings in the region, province, country to do political outreach. So I think those are a number of really neat opportunities. And then lastly, looking ahead, you know, if you want to support a patient KT agent, you can do it. You actually have to just say to yourself, let's start doing it. That's sometimes the hardest part. And I would argue that you do it in ways that are of interest to you and where you have knowledge to execute. And when you have success, success breeds success. I think thinking incrementally in your approach as a place to start is always good. Building relationships and communicating openly with patient KT agents like me is critical. There shouldn't be any secrets or secret handshakes. You have to share. Sharing is caring. And, of course, as I just said, patients are voters, too, and we have a right to tell government about our views, experiences, and research findings. Sometimes when you cannot speak, you can, and you can speak quite loudly. We are government. All of us are government partners. Researchers, healthcare providers, patients, public, we are in it together to help government achieve their agenda. We make up government. We make up funding agencies. We are the people that power what happens to us. And I love this painting by Alex Colville, our beloved Canadian artist, she's always looking ahead. And I would encourage all of us in our community to continue to work together to build more patient PT agents. They're not born, we actually build them. And it's how we build them responsibly in a loving and caring way, I think, that breeds success. It is, being a patient KT, I have to tell you, has delivered unbelievable health benefits to me. I understand, because of the literature, what I should do or not do. So I think every patient should become a patient KT agent, because they're going to get better. You understand the results of your hard work and can hopefully incorporate them into your life. So I just want to stop there and thank you for participating, and let's connect. I think the webinar series is very appropriately titled, and those are the ways that you can connect with us through social media.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. This is such a wonderfully engaging webinar. Thank you. So we now welcome all participants to submit any questions you might have via the chat panel. And just while we wait for some of those questions to come in, I did have a question of my own to ask.
And sure.
I'd be interested to know, when you partner with researchers or research trainees even, what kind of quality do you sort of look for in a good researcher partner?
Oh, I love this. You're turning the tables here. I love it. Openness. Trustworthiness. Someone who is, I know these are really kind of esoteric kind of things perhaps coming from academia, right? But people are people. So being real, truly interested in engaging with your patient, KT agent, helping to be, being interested in helping us become one if we're not already one, having a sense of humor. Remember, when you deal with patient PC agents, patients in general, public, we are living with, you know, terrible poker hands, I like to think of it. And you have to be sensitive to the fact that you're, you know, we're struggling. We struggle every day. People look at me, my disease, I'm blessed, it's well controlled right now. But I've had horrible periods, and, you know, it affects you, so your mood changes. So, being sensitive to that, I think it's just basic human qualities that we look for in youngsters coming up through research that really matter to us. It's not that you're the smartest. You don't have to be the smartest.
So I have another question that's come in.
Yeah.
If in the future there is a more powerful, better funded patient KT agent network, what role do you see it taking? Vis-a-vis the government and democratic decision-making?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. It's very interesting. I get invited to go to meetings a lot, and I say, who else, like me, will be there? And they always say, I'm it. And I say, well, geez, I know, having had this experience, there's going to be 30 people around the table, and most of them will be academics. So I walk in the room, and basically my vote means nothing. My voice is so, even though I have a huge voice, thank you, you know, mom and dad for letting me grow up in a gym and play volleyball. So even though my voice is loud and I'm prepared to use it, my perspective is weakened because there's only one of me. And if I start to state my perspective too many times, I'm viewed as a single person to be dominating the talk time. But in actual fact, when there's more people with one perspective coming forward, that's the dominant factor. So I think developing panels, putting more KT agents, patient KT agents, in positions of governance. So, for example, when you talk about inviting patients, well, first of all, there's a problem when the patient has to be invited. There's got to be a mechanism that we create where we're part of the invitation process even. And I think we've got ways to go. Certainly, I know CIHR is trying, Nicholas Smith, ARC, many of your research organizations are trying hard. to find a way to make it work. But I'm going to say to you, you can't just pick one person or one person like me who's, you know, tall, blonde, and white. You have to have diversity and having, I think, the biggest question, which is unanswered, is how do we engage underserved populations at positions of governance? How do we bring in the diversity, the age differences, the beautiful rainbow of colors that make up patients, that make up patient KT? So I don't have the answer. It's a very good question, but I'm suggesting we need to do more of what's being done now.
Right. And kind of building on from that, I guess, the work that you're doing, mm-hmm. you know, to bridge the gap between arthritis research and makeup is so impressive. What about other organizations doing similar work in other areas, other disease groups or other areas of research you're aware?
Yeah, so IUMSA, so the arthritis patient community, we are now fairly established. ACE was the first to form. You know, we're certainly the largest, but we live alongside our sister organizations, as I explained earlier. But we weren't the first. I mean, arthritis consumer experts, the whole concept of bringing people together and running an organization from the street, so to speak, came from HIV. My mentors as KT agents, patient KT agents, came from cancer and came from HIV. Because when I looked out on the horizon for best practice, as researchers do, my lit review was just looking across the horizon, and the internet wasn't what it is today, I can tell you, so it's harder to see the horizon. But HIV and cancer were the best practice sort of model, and I really credit Louise Binder, who has championed the HIV AIDS community issues forever. You know, I give her so much credit, and Pat Kelly, who was involved in cancer advocacy at the time, and they were my mentors. So, and we have continued to look across the MSK border, so to speak, for best practice, and I think we've done, you know, a good job feeling in a respectable way, you know, with acknowledgement. Some of their examples and trying to put the MSK lens on them. So we work actively with them every day. I actually think pan-disease activities are really important, and it's why we share the patient input process. We've given webinars for other communities on particular disease or let's say medication or research topics because there's overlap. The inflammation, which drives so much of what happens in inflammatory arthritis or autoimmune arthritis, is shared by MS, by Parkinson's, by cardiovascular disease, in cancer. Inflammation is king or queen. And so naturally, by virtue of what's happening to us in our bodies, there are opportunities to collaborate.
We do maybe have just maybe 1 minute left for okay. One last question. What do you think is the first step for an organization or a group that wants to start with developing patient KT agents?
I think reach out to those groups who are doing it. Reach out to the organizations who are doing it successfully. Maybe reach out to parties who aren't doing it successfully. I mean, you've got to take kind of the challenges and the successes and mix them up. I think that creates a beautiful sort of petri dish in which to peer. Down. So I would certainly do that. I think the BC support unit is doing, I think, a really good job, as are the other support units, at trying to identify the, you know, the who, how, what, for, why kind of principles. And I think talking to the public about what you're trying to do is a really important place to start. It's everything. I think whether you have the answers or not, you're more credible, you're more real to people on the street when you talk to them at all of the stages. You know, I hear people in institutions telling, yeah, but we're not quite ready yet. And I just push back. That's not right. You are ready. You are ready to tell the public what you're doing every day. You have to be ready. is it that you want us to be your partner, to build relationships, to be champions, to be, you know, successful together in this process of PT? You have to do it every day. I'm really proud to see these support units across the country inundating my inbox now. And I get emails from support units almost every day, and I'm like, right on. That's what it's about. I didn't choose to turn you off or turn you down, but I think that's really, really important. Start talking.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So that concludes our question and answer period today, but before we wrap up, I really do want to sincerely thank you, Cheryl. That was an excellent webinar. Thank you. So your feedback is very important to us, of course, so please, if you can, please take a few moments to share your thoughts on today's webinar. A link to a brief survey is now added to the chat box, and alternatively, it will also be shared via email after the webinar. And also after the webinar, for more information on NEKT, and to explore our resources, you can visit www.msfhr.org/our-work/activities/knowledge-translation. And an archived webinar recording of today's session will also be at the link on the screen now. And we hope you'll consider joining us for our next webinar entitled Economic Evaluation and Knowledge Translation, Some Thoughts on Building a Two-Way Street. It's presented by Sterling Bryan on Thursday, May 18th at the same time, 12 p.m. Pacific time. So that concludes our webinar for today. And for everyone still on the line, we want to thank you again for joining us. And we hope you join us again with Sterling Bryan for his webinar on May 18th. And have a great day, everyone. You are now free to disconnect.